Hello.
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 Hello. Hello, my name is Matthew West, and I'm the host of this podcast. It's called the Matthew West Podcast. I really hope you like it.
Hello.
Guys, I have some friends who have a company called Simply Earth, and it's an essential oil recipe box company. And I was always super confused by essential oils until I partnered up with them. And they have eliminated all the confusion, and they help make the air in my home toxin-free. It'll do the same for you. But most importantly, this is a company that is about a greater cause. Not just helping make the air in your home toxin-free, they donate 13% of their profits to help end human trafficking. They actually came up with that number 13, inspired by one of my songs, Next Thing You Know. So there's a real personal connection with this company. They're mission-minded, and they're helping to end human trafficking. And when you buy your essential oils from them, you get to take part in that fight against trafficking, which is a big deal. The company's called Simply Earth, and here's what happens. You get a Simply Earth essential oil recipe box that helps you gain confidence and clarity in using essential oils. You're going to receive the recipe box with 4 pure essential oils, 6 recipe cards, and extras. You'll learn how to use your essential oils while making the recipes that are created by certified aromatherapists. I want to become a certified aromatherapist. That's a nice title. You save money and you detoxify your life. Plus, you buy from a company that's changing the world. 13% of their profits go to end human trafficking. This is like a meal subscription kit, but it's way more fun, and it's going to detoxify your home, and you're going to help change other people's lives. So here's what I want you to do. Remember this, the essential oils alone would cost over $100 from other companies, but with the Simply Earth Essential Oil Recipe Box, you get 4 pure oils, 6 recipes, and extra ingredients for only $39. And when you subscribe, you get a free big bonus box with even more natural goodies. It's never been easier to use essential oils. You got to sign up. And when you sign up with Simply Earth's Essential Oil Recipe Box, you get a free 80 milliliter essential oil diffuser when you subscribe using our URL, simplyearth.com/west. Again, that's simplyearth.com/west. What's up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of the Matthew West Podcast. I'm your host, Matthew West. And as always, I really hope you like it. Thank you for joining me today. I'm wearing a special shirt for a special reason. I'm not sure if you recognize this logo, but it's old school Chicago Cubs. And my guest today shares my love of the Chicago Cubs because we both grew up in Illinois. So we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about more interesting stuff than that. But you just had to know the why of this shirt today. First, I'm so excited that our fall tour is right around the corner. We're getting excited to head out on the road. Love for you to come and join me on the My Story, Your Glory tour. Select amount of dates taking place. Our special guest is my good buddy, Micah Tyler, who we've had on the podcast before. This is going to be epic. So I think there's only 20 cities this fall, so be sure to come and see us. Also, there's been a handful of Christmas dates that have gone on sale, and that's a totally different kind of concert that we're really excited to bring to, again, a select amount of cities. So not doing as many concerts here towards the end of the year as we normally might do. So be sure to come and see us. Go to MatthewWest.com/tour for all of the information on that. And let's dive into today's show. My guest today, you know, we have a segment on our show called Songs from the Story House, right? And it's usually a very short segment. But I was thinking I wanted to pepper in some guests who work in the music industry with me, and who are just incredibly successful and incredibly talented, and giving you guys a chance to kind of see inside the music making process and hear from some of the best about why they do Christian music and what they're all about. And so today's guest is a writer and producer. He's one of the top songwriters and producers in all of Christian music, former band member of mine as well. And you're going to love this conversation today. So let's go to the Story House with the BMI Songwriter of the Year, Jeff Pardo. Today, we get to welcome to the Story House a good friend of mine, happens to be the BMI Songwriter of the Year, Billboard's top Christian producer of the year, I believe, currently? Or did you get knocked
2022.
Off?
2022. So
ouch. So 2023,
it'll
not so
probably
much.
Be
It'll probably be somebody else.
He's also the reason why I'm wearing this shirt today, a Chicago Cubs shirt,
Cubs.
Because he shares my affinity for all things Chicago sports, but also takes it to dangerous extremes.
Yes.
And so good friend of mine. We're going to get to talk about music and all the things today. Mr. Jeff Pardo is here. Round of applause. Listen to that.
Thank you. Thank you.
It's
you
good to
that?
Be here. Yes,
that
I hear
sounds
that.
Sounds like the first several years of my concerts. Just my mother applauding in the background.
Yay, Matthew.
Thanks for being here.
Yes, thanks for having me.
You're no stranger to this room.
I'm not.
But
I'm not a stranger. Yes, I'm not a stranger to this room.
But we haven't, like this, I always talk with the podcast listeners about like the songs that are born at the Story House.
Yeah.
Truth be told, there are songs that are born at the Story House, but then because you live in another part of town and we write a lot of songs together, you force me out of the Story House and I have to drive
Story House Mobile
to the east part of Nashville.
Yes.
East Nasty, which is where Jeff Pardo lives.
Yes,
and you're one of the only people that I will travel away from the Story House to go create with.
Well, I'm honored. I'm honored you get in your car and drive 15 minutes.
So honestly, the only reason I had you on the podcast today was to find a way to force you
to make me to come here. Yeah.
But let's talk about that for a second. The reason why I come to your house is, you know, as a producer and a writer, like you have equipment,
mm-hmm.
right? More so than I do.
Yep.
I'm like a, you know, I'm more guitar, piano.
Yep.
You've got all the gear.
Yep.
And you've got a pretty sweet setup at your house. And that's what you need. You need to be in your element too, right?
Yeah. Sometimes it's helpful just to have my own, the tools I'm familiar with from a, you know, the computer and microphones. And so an artist, especially if we're writing with a different artist. Well, but you too, like the ability to like go in my vocal booth and immediately start singing and just have me.
It's dialed in.
Yeah. It's just where I'm comfortable and I'm confident in what I'm hearing, which is as a producer, that's sort of the baseline for where I can start judging like, does this sound good? Or
yeah.
Does this just sound loud? Or, you know, and it's not that I have no perspective other places, but it's helpful to sometimes be in my own environment.
You've got it dialed in.
Yeah.
You also have the lighting dialed in. You have this really cool lighting
yes.
feature that's like
the Hue.
It's like a spaceship.
The Philips Hue.
That's lighting. What it is?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. When I redid, so a couple years ago, I redid my studio. My wife and I have lived in that house. We're in our 11th year. So I was in there for 9 years when it just looked different. And 2 years ago, I felt like, I need this place to feel new again, but we're not moving.
Right.
So the studio went back down to the walls, kind of the bare walls. And
yeah.
Then, excuse me. Niles company in Nashville, which does a lot of studios, kind of rebuilt it. And they do all this cool lighting stuff. So all of the lighting all over the studio is all the Hue lighting. So I can change all the colors. I can, you know.
Yeah, and we got to get it just right when I'm singing.
That's like right.
And the studio looks awesome. I would have gone with a hot tub instead of the automated lighting. But,
fair. Yes.
But so let's talk about that for a second because like being at the Story House, like I created this space because I've always been the kind of person that like, even when I was looking to buy a house, like I remember when I was trying to buy my first house in Nashville, I was looking at houses in East Nashville.
Yeah.
And I remember walking into like old houses and going, my first thought was, could I write songs in here?
Mm-hmm.
And I think my wife walks into a house and doesn't think anything about
that's
that,
right?
And most yep. people don't. Your wife probably doesn't. But you walk into a space and go, does this feel creative, right?
Oh, I like, mean, so we built our house in East Nashville. It was kind of a crazy situation. We found out there was this empty lot that is now our house that was owned by my next door neighbor, Miss Mary, who has lived in her house since 1968. She's the grandma of the street. She owned both lots, sold this lot that our house is on to this builder, and we just happened to find out about it at the right time. But one of the decision makers was, oh, this is a deep enough lot, and it works within our budget that we can build the studio. I mean,
right.
that was a decision maker for the house.
Yeah, it's like our home businesses.
Yes.
Like, but then the ambiance inside, it does matter, doesn't it?
100%.
Like, I don't know that my wife, like I'd always joke with Emily about for years, like the tiniest room in the house was the room where that was my music room.
Yeah.
And I would always joke like this tiniest room has to pay for the rest of the house. Like,
yes.
So that's why like
yes.
The Story House was born. Like for once, let me have like the space.
Yeah.
And to walk into a space, it probably sounds weird from an outside perspective to go, wait, you need the lighting to be right to create.
Right.
And the reality is we've written on tour buses. We've written, we can write anywhere, but there is something special about having that space dialed.
Oh man. Yeah. And I think especially in my role too, as a producer working with just a lot of different artists, like I really want artists to come in and feel immediately at home and that it's a safe space and it's a space that they want to be in.
Yeah.
And that they're comfortable singing in and comfortable being their authentic selves. And so, you know, it's all part of my, I think, feel like part of my job and my role is to help people feel comfortable being vulnerable and opening up, because that's where the songs come from that are the songs that the world connects with.
That's the good stuff.
And I think aesthetic matters, and I think space matters in the environment you create either. I mean, and that's not even, I think, unique or specific to artists. We all know what it feels like to walk into a house or a restaurant or a place where you kind of go, something is a little off about this. And even if you can't put your finger on what it is, it does something in your spirit.
Yeah.
And then we know the opposite too, of walking into a space where you go, man, I feel really at home here.
Cracker
I feel
barrel.
Like I can, Cracker Barrel. Yeah.
You know that feeling where you're like, I need a nap. And
I'm going to sit on a rocking chair outside.
But there is, like, there's something about, like, you know, like being on the road, which, you know, for the listeners who don't know, our friendship began long before we were writing songs.
Yeah.
You were a member of the band.
Yeah.
We toured together for how many years?
Five years.
Yeah. And you were basically band leader, keyboard player. Yeah. You play multiple instruments, but on tour you focused.
Yeah, it was all keys.
On keys before coming off the road, focusing wholeheartedly on writing and producing. So we've lived a lot of life together.
Totally.
We've watched a lot of football together.
That's totally true.
We've made a lot of memories together. Guys, I get to tell you about the NIV Bible for Men. It's new from the Zondervan Bible Publishers. It's designed to help you connect with your identity in Christ. You guys know I write a lot of songs about the topic of identity because it is so important to make sure that our identities are firmly rooted in who God says we are. And the NIV Bible for Men is going to help you do just that. They've got some really unique features like myth articles that expose commonly accepted myths of our culture and refute them with God's Word. Profiles of men and women of the Bible, so you go deeper into the character study. Notes that offer clarity into the attributes of God, so knowing who you are, where does that begin? It begins outside of yourself by knowing who God is. Questions for growth that you can answer alone, with a friend, or in a small group. Bibles offer the knowledge, strength, and clarity to navigate life's challenge with Scripture as your guide. It's available in hardcover or leather soft style, so it could be a great gift for the men or man in your life. Find out more and order your copy at amazon.com/rootedandflourish. That's amazon.com/rootedandflourish. You talk about writing and working with a lot of other artists and bringing them into your studio space. Let's just talk a little bit about, let's list some of those artists. Like even on the charts right now, this moment, you've got songs that you've written or produced or both by...
So this week that we're recording this, Big Daddy Weave has the number one song. Heaven Changes Everything that we wrote with Mike. So I've known Mike for years. He's been in that room multiple times at different records for him. Ann Wilson has been there a lot the past couple of years. Micah Tyler.
Mm-hmm.
In a couple of weeks, artist I love named Riley Clemens has a new record coming out. We did her whole new record there. New artist named Caleb and John, those guys are great.
Yep.
They've been there.
Hallelujah Feeling is their single.
Hallelujah
right now.
Feeling.
Kane,
yes, my gosh, yes. I mean, Kane's been there. I've worked on a lot of their new record.
Laura Story.
I did a Christmas song
not
for Laura Story.
Story one time ago. Katie Nicole.
Oh, Katie.
That's what I meant. I was thinking
God is in the story. Jeff
Laura,
Farrow. Katie. Yeah, yeah. Katie Nicole.
You wrote
certainly.
God is in the Story.
Yep.
You're a writer on...
In Jesus' Name.
In Jesus' Name.
I produced those songs
Massive
for her.
Massive song.
Yep.
So you've had all of them over at your studio, your writing, talking about being vulnerable. I think that writing session with Mike Weaver, who's been a guest on the podcast.
Yeah.
That had to be one of the most vulnerable sessions that you and I were like, I know we both felt really like privileged to be
100%
in the room as Mike shared about the loss of his brother. And then a song like that that's a perfect example.
And a song like that does not happen if an artist is not comfortable in a space with the people he's with or she's with, emoting and being just, here is my heart. Like, that song doesn't happen.
Yeah. And so, and you're working with a lot of, you'll always, one thing I've always noticed about you is you're not afraid to work with the up and coming artist either, who hasn't, like, you're not saying to your publisher, hey, don't set me up to write with somebody unless, you know, they've already got hits.
Yep.
It's, you don't overlook the underdog
or just the new,
the unknown artist.
Yeah. And I hope I never will. Cause I think it's two things. One is every artist, every producer, every songwriter starts somewhere. And it's like there were people earlier in my career that were like giving me opportunities that maybe I didn't totally deserve yet or wasn't ready for. But that's how, you know, like
somebody
came
gave
out
you
of
a
that.
Shot.
Yeah. And the new artist of today, the person who's writing their first round of songs, like, it's weird how quickly I think perception goes. Katie's a perfect example of somebody who, you know, a year and a half ago, it's like this brand new artist, Katie Nicole.
Yeah.
And then you have a few songs in a row that are big and mean stuff to people. And it's like, well, she's not a new artist anymore, you know, but if you don't, in my opinion, it's like part of my job is to make time, emotional, musical investments in people at the beginning. And I love, Micah Tyler is a perfect example of this too, where Micah signed his record deal like 9 in the morning one day, came to my studio at 10 in the morning. Hi, I'm Micah Tyler. I'm Jeff Pardo. We wrote 2 songs that day. The first song we wrote was Never Been a Moment. And that was
Never
his first single. Yeah, and that was his
that
first
was
single.
His first hit.
That was my first number one song as a songwriter.
Wow.
And that's as new as you get. And having his song out on the radio right now called Praise the Lord, like, that's, you know, we're 7 years. I mean, soon to be 8 years. I mean, in terms of how long we've been working together, it's 8 years.
Yeah, that's incredible.
So I just look at it as I love being there on the ground floor with somebody. And then it becomes this relationship that ends up transcending just what you do musically together.
Yeah. And you get to be a part of their creative statement from the beginning too. Yeah. And they're, have you found artists to be loyal? Like, You know, I think as artists develop and they have more success, then they're pulled into different rooms and different relationships. And writing relationships can kind of ebb and flow. But what I feel like is it says something about your abilities as a writer, but who you are as a person as well, to see like those writers have success with you and they still come back and write with you years later, even like you said with Michael.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think it's really important that an artist always feels the freedom to go where they feel they're being led to go, and they shouldn't have false loyalty to somebody. It's like, if the Lord's moving me into a different creative season that involves different people, then that's what you should do, because that's where your best
that's
stuff's
going to
be made.
That's part of it too,
But I do think... you know, it's really important to me that artists feel like I'm listening to them and that they're being served by me and what they need and what they want. Mm-hmm. And that I don't come into it with an agenda that's more about what kind of song do I want to write? What kind of record do I want to produce?
Yeah.
And hopefully that care, and I mean, it's really important to me, like that care I have for the process with them. I think that probably does create loyalty. But it's really just because hopefully their true artistic heart is being served by working with me.
Yeah,
not
absolutely.
Like, because Jeff writes hit songs that's gonna come and go. And I think
it comes back to the safe space too. Just like there's a comfortability and like going, hey, I enjoy that experience. I enjoy that person. We're friends.
Yep.
And I like seeing artists be loyal like that. And it's interesting what you say.
And I think you make me, I'm interrupting the host. You shouldn't do that on the podcast.
But not
I think,
a good host.
I do think that the more music you make together over time, the better you get.
Yeah.
And I think it's for artists and producers, like that when you get through that kind of like get to know you season creatively, you're starting from a place of comfort and of confidence. And I think it leads to better music. And I think that happens over time.
Yeah. You know? And I think your story, what I was thinking about before you interrupted me was, I was thinking about how you were saying like every artist needs someone to like make an opportunity for them, right? Yeah. To like, and what's interesting is I think people's perception in Nashville in the music industry, and this happens probably all across life, is if they know you as one thing, it's hard for them to see you as another,
right?
And so even like, I've it's funny because you talk about that with other young artists and you're making space for the unknown artist and believing in them and giving them a shot. But it's also like, your story is a story of perseverance as a creator, producer, and writer.
Yes.
And like, you started, you know, live musician on the road with me. And it's for years, like I saw you in that light of like band member, super talented, great piano player. But I never really like saw you as songwriter, producer.
Right.
And then as time passes, you start to see like the, and it's probably the, you start to see yourself more in that light.
Yeah.
Others see yourself in that light, but your story was not a quick like catapult to success.
Man, so
like,
let's
talk about that just a little bit. Like, obviously you grew up in the Chicago suburbs.
Yeah, I grew up in a town called Arlington Heights. So I'm diehard Cubs fan, diehard Bears fan. Don't like the White Sox at all. You do have to pick one.
Yeah. Well,
I mean, if you don't pick one, how can I trust anything?
But you're the kind of fan who believes every year is the year.
Yeah, I mean, I do. Like, I feel like I text you. I feel like you text me before football seasons about the Bears and are basically—
I text you negative.
You text me negative and I'm like, no man, listen, this year, Justin Fields, this is, we're going into year three. This is the, you know, and I've been saying that for 15 years.
And I'm always way more pessimistic, but yeah. I just like to get you
right. But you're more pessimistic, but more historically correct.
Thank you. So were you, I mean, obviously— family discovered a musical gifting in you from an early age?
Yeah, I started, it's kind of funny. My best friend growing up was this guy named Steve Green. Steve started playing piano before I did. And part of the reason I started playing piano, and I was more into sports. He was always a good, like we'd play baseball together and stuff, but I was like more into it. He started playing piano a year before I played piano. And I was like, oh, I'm gonna play piano. And by our senior year in high school, he was the quarterback of the football team.
And you
and I was the music kid. I was the one writing songs and like doing my own recording and all that stuff. It was like a total flip. But yeah, so I started playing piano in third grade and I started writing songs pretty quickly. Like probably by fifth or sixth grade, I was pretty consistently just fooling around with melodies and words and learning how this stuff worked. It just felt very home for me very fast.
What was like, what was the music you gravitated towards at
my,
a young age?
Okay, so the first two albums I ever owned were given to me by my mom, and my joke is that they basically explained my whole career was Michael W. Smith, Go West, Young Man.
Wow.
And Billy Joel, River of Dreams.
Okay.
And so the piano thing, it was like the combination of these piano artists and Christian music. Christian music was very, you know, formative for me all through high school. So when I moved to Nashville and went to Belmont University,
which is like the school for the music that feeds the music industry.
Yeah, a lot of people come.
I mean,
to Nashville via Belmont.
Yes, yeah.
But I moved here thinking I wanted to be an artist because I'd like made a couple records on my own in high school and thought I wanted to sing my own songs,
like singer songwriter records.
Yeah, gotcha. I mean, and it was very inspired by Michael W., Stephen Chris Chapman, Jeff Moore, like all these guys who I was listening to in high school going, oh man, I love making music. I love writing songs. I love singing. One of the interesting things about Belmont, I've said this to many people over the years, is, you know, it's great to be in Nashville. All the stuff that they provide for, you know, for students and the way those relationships happen is really important. Opportunities, all this stuff. But one of the best things is the feedback you get that you didn't really ask for. And it's not even like, tell me what you think. It's just seeing the way people react. What I noticed when I was at Belmont my first 2 years was when I was playing keyboards with other people, when I was in the studio with other people, like working in student studios with other people, when I was writing songs with other people, other friends were coming around and going, hey, can you come play keyboards for me for my showcase? Or can you help me in the studio with my vocal? Or can you write a song with me? When it was Jeff the artist, the feedback was almost always like, yeah, I mean, that's... okay, whatever.
Interesting.
But can you come play keyboards for me? And there, the first like real gig I got was playing with this band called Denver and the Mile High Orchestra.
Oh, yeah.
Which came out of Belmont. It was a big band.
I remember that.
Yeah, Denver was the band leader. And so 7-piece horn section, 4-piece rhythm section.
In fact, he texted me a week ago.
Really?
Out of the blue, Denver did.
That's amazing.
He had some friends who were coming to a show and he wanted to get some tickets for.
That's awesome.
But yeah, I totally remember. I forgot you were in Denver.
Yeah, I played with Denver for a long time before I played for you. And that that band came out of Belmont, and I met two of the guys in the horn section. They were seniors at the time, and I got placed as a freshman into one of the like upper jazz combos. I played a bunch of jazz in high school, and so I met them my freshman year. I started being Denver's like sub keyboard player. This guy named Ben Shive was his keyboard player at the time, who's played for Andrew Peterson for 20 years. Yeah. He wrote "Is He Worthy?" He's great. But I became Denver's main keyboard player my sophomore, junior, I think it was the end of my sophomore year. And that was the moment. And it really was this Lord-led thing where I felt it was like, Jeff, if you keep holding on to this dream that you've had, you're going to miss the bigger thing. And so I remember kind of laying down Jeff as the artist, and it felt like this little death. You know, it felt like, oh, I'm letting go of something that I've thought about for a long, long, long time to embrace something that I don't know fully what it means yet.
Wow.
You know? But I think in, I mean,
I didn't know that part of your story. Like, we've known each other for a long time, but I don't think I ever knew that.
Yeah, it was, I mean, it was significant, but very quickly it became evident that it was like, oh, this is what I was actually made for. You know, and I'm not made to be the person at the front of the stage. I'm made to be the person at the back of the stage that's helping equip the person at the front of the stage to go out and feel confident in what they're doing. And so I really like, you know, I think with any of our careers in any, it's not just about music, but at any point in your life, you can always, like, if you trace back, there's these anchor decisions that like lead to, the fork in the road is now going this way. And then there's other branches that come, but it's like, if this hadn't happened here,
100%,
this decision that led to this whole other way of living my life that I didn't know was going to happen, I mean, I probably wouldn't be sitting here.
Yeah.
You know, because I would have held on too long to like, I want to be an artist, and I would have missed these other relational kind of what became foundational spots in my career.
Or you would have had your own podcast and I'd be a guest.
Well,
on
or
yours.
That, or you'd be on my podcast as the guitar player.
How long after you graduated from Belmont University did you begin to like think, I want to be a full-time songwriter?
Yeah.
I want to go get a publishing deal.
So I probably started really pursuing that like 2 years after I graduated.
Okay.
And again, it was like, I didn't totally understand what that meant. Like, oh, I'm going to get a publishing deal. I'm going to be a full-time songwriter. But I mean, I'd written songs my whole life, and I knew I was falling more in love with making records and like working on different independent records with artists and like starting to hone that craft a bit. So I mean, I signed my first publishing deal. It would have been the fall of, I think, 2007.
Was that with the publisher that you're still with today? Or
no, that was with Simpleville.
Simple, that's right. Duh.
Yeah.
Which was my
Your
my
brother.
Yeah.
Joel.
I totally forgot about it.
Yeah. So I met you. So here's another one of these things where like I was, the publisher I'm with now, I'm in my 12th year, I think, is Capital CMG. They're a big Christian music company. I almost signed there before I met Joel. I met Joel and was like, I need to be with this guy. I like his vision and all this.
Yeah.
Joel left his position at Simpleville.
Right.
A year into my deal to start managing you in the season where you guys were working together, which is how I got connected with you.
That's
because
right.
Then Joel was like, hey, Matthew needs, I mean, I've told a few people, it's like, oh, Matthew needs a keyboard player for like 10 shows. So I agreed to play 10 shows and then I stayed for 5 years, you know? So, but again, all these little things where you trace it back and you go, well, this decision to not sign with Capitol, I ended up meeting and playing for you for 5 years. And like, and the reality is playing your songs on stage in front of people was helpful for me as a songwriter because you were a lot further ahead in your career than I was. And I was learning
like form or just,
I think more heart and emotion, like watching what people really connected with.
I thought you were going to say you learned how to put woes in a song or something.
Well, that too. Just add some woes and maybe it'll be a hit song.
These nonverbal sounds that
playing Hello, My Name Is for, you know, 200 times or whatever.
Hey, did you guys know that most children's vitamins have some unhealthy stuff in them? It's like, the old song, just a spoonful of sugar. A lot of unhealthy chemicals and other gummy junk in these vitamins that growing kids really shouldn't eat. And that's why Hiya was created, H-I-Y-A. It's a pediatrician-approved, super-powered, chewable vitamin. Most children's vitamins are filled with 5 grams of sugar and they contribute to a variety of health issues. Well, Hiya is made with zero sugar and zero gummy junk, and yet it tastes great even for the picky eaters in your life. It was formulated with the help of nutritional experts Haya is pressed with a blend of 12 organic fruits and veggies and then supercharged with 15 essential vitamins and minerals, including vitamin D, B12, C, and zinc, folate, and many others to help support immunity, energy, brain function, mood, concentration. Who doesn't need help in that, right? It's non-GMO, vegan, dairy-free, allergy-free, gelatin-free, nut-free, and everything else you can imagine. It's designed for kids of all ages and sent straight to your door so parents have one less thing to worry about. Your kids are gonna love it. Trust me on this, Haya is a healthy way to make sure you're getting the vitamins and all the nutrition that you need. We've worked out a special deal with Haya for their best-selling children's vitamin. Receive 50% off your first order. To claim this deal, you must go to Haya.com/West. It's not available on their regular website, so go to HIYAHEALTH.com/West and get your kids the full body nourishment that they need to turn into healthy adults. Check it out. That's crazy. So then, okay, 2007, you signed your first publishing songwriting deal.
Yep.
Do you remember how long it was when until you got your first song recorded by somebody?
Well, so I came into that deal again.
You had a song random, recorded?
Yeah, so I'd worked a lot with a guy named Josh Wilson as an independent artist.
Of course, we love Josh.
Yeah, when he signed his record deal, I kind of came along with that. It's like, oh, he's this new songwriter guy. And that's how I mean, I don't know who connected me with Joel, but it would have been, Josh would have been part of that.
Like, yeah.
Oh, Jeff's this Jeff guy.
Okay.
But I also met a girl named Francesca Battistelli.
Right.
Josh introduced me to her at a Panera Bread.
And you had-
Totally random. And I wrote a couple songs with her before I had a deal.
You had
a
big Christmas song with her, I think, didn't you?
Yeah, we've had a couple together. We wrote a song called Messiah that did really well, and then a song called Behold Him.
Yes.
But I had a couple songs on her very first album. Again, it's been-
Which was a big seven, album.
Big album, yep. And again, I mean, I met Franny in a Panera before she became Francesca Battistelli and
this
big new artist and all that stuff.
And as you've developed in your career, obviously you get more opportunities. You had the chance to write songs outside of contemporary Christian music. Mm-hmm. You've written like one of my favorite singer-songwriters, Ben Rector.
Ben Rector, yep.
You've written, I need to have him on the show. Let's get him.
Let's get Jeff out of here. Get Ben in here.
But you've there's a great song you wrote. Well, several with Ben. Two are my favorites. They're so much my favorite that I can't think of what
that's
they are.
That's right. No, you love like this.
Never
one of your favorites.
Known a love
yeah,
like
that's,
this.
Yeah.
Great. And that to me is as much as people know Ben Rector, they're like, oh, that's quintessential Ben Rector.
Yeah.
But knowing you, I'm like, that's quintessential Jeff Pardo. The
funny thing about working with Ben, and I think Ben would say this too, because I'm a piano player and he's such a great piano player and we kind of see the world similarly when it comes to the musicality of a lot of his stuff.
Yeah.
There's probably lyrics and musical things that people would assume was like, oh yeah, that's so Ben. Ben definitely wrote that. And it was like, that was actually me sitting at the piano right. And just trying to, but again, that's part of my calling. It's like inhabit these artists' worlds, like try to be a chameleon and speak authentically for.
Isn't being a chameleon like a big part of it?
To
work with multiple artists? Because if you write with multiple artists and you only have your thing that you do,
I'm not, like, then I'm not serving
that's not going to last long either. Mm-hmm. Because the artists need, their identity needs to be what is at the forefront.
Yes.
So it's so true.
But the Ben thing is unique just because we both play piano in similar ways. And so we can sort of sit down and just pick up where each other left
Y'all
off.
Need to be writing more because I feel like there's a magic when you guys write songs together.
I agree.
But so what I was getting at is you've had songs in commercials,
mm-hmm.
you know, film and television, just kind of behind the scenes doing lots of different things. But you always come back to Christian music.
I do.
What's the motivation behind that?
I think it's just always felt like home for me. And there was a period in my career, probably 5 or 6 years ago, where I was really more actively exploring, should I write more country songs? Or should I try to write more pop songs? Or should I, you know? But Christian music was always so formative for me, like I said earlier. And it's just, I've said a few times, I think, you know, if a career is like a tree, you have to have something that's the trunk of the tree. And like Christian music has always been the trunk of the tree for me.
Mm.
And I think there's branches that have come from that. But so many of even those have been rooted in a relationship that I had within Christian music, that then somebody introduced me to this other person that was outside of Christian music. But even they looked at my work and were like, oh yeah, you do a lot in Christian music. It's just always felt like where the Lord's called me to, you know, plant my seeds.
Talk about moments where being behind the scenes as a writer and a producer, you're not always getting to experience the impact that a song might be having, other than looking at, oh, it's number one this week, or it's on the charts or whatever. But I always feel like when people ask me, like, why do you do Christian music? It's like, I can say, man, I get a front row seat to see how Christ-centered music and lyrics like impacts people's lives on a different level than other music.
Yeah.
Music is a powerful thing, period. Totally. You know what I mean? But there's just, I always joke, like, no offense to Scotty McCreery, but I've never had anybody tell me like, hey, that song about summertime that you wrote with Scotty
really changed my life. Like, it got me through it.
Got me through a hard time. Maybe had a good day at the beach that day, and that song was part of the soundtrack. That's cool.
That's great.
But like, there's just a different level where I feel like you kind of get ruined a little bit for ordinary. But talk about being behind the scenes and not always getting that first hand. Are there moments you can remember or think of one moment where you've been given a front row seat to see one of your songs performed or how it impacted a crowd?
I feel like every time I've gone, because I don't get to a lot of shows either because artists are out on tour and they're not always playing in Nashville.
I know we went to, you and I took the tour bus to Ann Wilson show.
I mean, I could talk about that. Yeah, out with Casting Crowns and seeing people. It was the first time I'd seen her perform My Jesus.
Yeah.
And again, I mean, you said it right. Like I'm on the periphery of what's actually happening.
Right.
I hear like, oh, people are streaming this song a lot and it's doing this on the radio and all that. Seeing people in a room sing it and how they all their voices got louder on that song, you know? I mean, it's important for me to experience those moments that it's like, oh, these songs, they're not just going out into the void. I'm just not there for the 140 dates a year that an artist is out there singing it.
And you probably get to hear from the artists themselves as well about the impact made.
And artists are, you know, I'll have sometimes people will send me a story or tell me something somebody said to them on the road about a song. And I mean, it's incredible. It's really, it's affirming and it's inspiring to keep doing it.
Yeah.
That it's like, it's real people having very real reactions in their own lives to these things that we make.
And I think it's important for like the people who like even who listen to this podcast or listen to these artists' music to know like the people behind it.
Sure.
And to see their, like, that's why I was excited to have you talk about your process and your why, because it's like to see that the people behind it who are making it they're just as determined to put something into the world that's going to impact people. Like, not just a job. We treat it like a job in terms of our work ethic, and nobody works harder than you, except for me, maybe. But, so talk about your weekly. I just want people to understand how hard you have to work in order to achieve what type of success you're achieving right now. But like, give us your average week.
I would say the average or my ideal average week is I'm writing two songs a week.
That's
maybe
all.
Three. Because of the producer.
You don't have to
sit there and put the vocals together.
Yes, like, that's what I want to get at.
Yeah. I mean, so as a producer, like on almost every song I write, there's a musical track building element to making a demo of a song, and that takes time, you know, like, so I my ideal weeks are I'm writing between two, maybe three songs a week, and the other days in the week are set aside for just me working by myself or working with musicians or whatever, kind of making, I might be working on a record for somebody, I might be working on the demo of the song I just wrote, but kind of me in the studio making progress on those things, because I don't like the feeling of getting really behind on things.
Yeah,
because that's creatively deflating to me.
And that's where your skill sets allow you to be involved in the song's progression from start to finish as a not just as a writer, but as a producer, where a guy like me, I'll come in, I'll write the song with y'all.
Yep.
And then I'm going to write another song.
That's right.
And you're going, I got to I've seen the work that goes into it, and I want nothing. I want no part of that.
Yeah, it's just a different gift, you know. And like everybody needs everybody. I mean, I love the, you know, the transformation, the feeling that happens seeing a song start with just playing the piano and then become.
Yeah,
you know. I mean, right before I came over here this morning, I'm working on this Christmas song, and I got these background vocals back from a great background singer who sang, and I put him in the track, and I'm just like, this is
amazing.
I love music. Yeah. You know, just that feeling of seeing the record part of it come together.
Yeah.
I love that. And it, so it does mean that I'm writing less songs than I probably could,
but
I'm deeper involved in most of them.
And you maybe get burned out if you know what I mean? If it wasn't, I mean, I think the fact that you're able to see a song from start to finish gives you a greater understanding when you go write another song.
Yeah.
Like just the depth of understanding.
And again, I mean, it goes back to like being deeply involved with these artists that give me an opportunity to be deeply involved with them.
Yeah.
Like I want to be in the weeds on that music and really making sure everything is as good as it can be.
It's speaking of being in the weeds, it's funny because I was thinking as we're talking, I was like, this is a fun conversation where like we get to kind of geek out a little bit and go into the weeds about the writing process. And hopefully it's enjoyable for the listener as well. If you've ever wondered how these songs are made, I was thinking about a lot of times when we write, you can play guitar and stuff too, and you'll pick up a guitar and start writing. And I'll always be the one who gives you a hard time going,
play piano. Better at piano.
Well, just cause you're such a good piano player that it's, and you can do it all, but it's like there's chord progressions you'll come up with. So I always joke with you. So I was thinking, like, how can I get Jeff to play piano on the podcast today? And then it hit me. We have a segment most weeks called Songs from the Story House. And I was like, that could be it.
Piano.
We could do Songs from the Story House live from the Story House.
And
maybe you hit the piano gently.
Very loudly.
And Dennis Quaid was here a few weeks ago. And he played... Great Balls of Fire. Remember that movie? He did Jerry Lee Lewis.
Yes.
He walks in, he sees the piano, he goes, oh, that's a nice piano. I didn't know he really played. He sat down and just started ripping into Great Balls of Fire.
And he played it.
I was like, dude. He's like, yeah, I learned it for the movie. I was like, holy cow. It's pretty crazy.
That's incredible.
I think he's like, yeah, it's amazing what you can do when you're on cocaine. That's not what he said, but he did say that he went to cocaine college.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Okay, so I was thinking we could, I just want to hear you play a little bit.
Yeah.
We're going to step into Songs from the Story House. So we're going to head over to the piano, Songs from the Story House, live with Jeff Pardo. What should we do? A little bit of...
I think we should do Me on Your Mind.
Me on Your Mind?
Since we wrote that together and it's a piano-y thing. And
we wrote that at Jeff's studio.
Yep.
So I talk about the ideas were born at the Story House.
Yep.
Born here and then on a walk with my wife, I took it over to the studio with Jeff and Ann Wilson. The three of us were writing for Ann's record.
Yep.
We finished a song that day. And at the end of that day, I brought up this idea feeling like I just... this song needed to be written. So this was the second song of the day. That I don't even think the first song has ever been heard.
No, I don't think it has either.
So this song was the song we wrote at the end of the day.
Yep.
It fell out pretty fast. The piano, I think when you hear that piano part, once you hear Jeff Pardo play, you're going to be like, oh, okay, because I can't play that good. So let's play a little bit of
that.
Let's
do it. All right.
Yep.
The crowd.
You're preparing a place where all the sorrows erase. And when I stand before you, I'll fight. All along, it was me on your mind.
Jeff Pardo, ladies and gentlemen. Songs from the Storyhouse, nicely done.
He's my dad. He gives good advice, and that's why we're closing out today's show with Dad Advice. Check out the theme song.
He is my dad, and he gives good advice, and that's why this segment is called Dad Advice.
Dad, thanks for joining me.
Thank you.
Will you send us out with some just some belly laughs from a dad joke, and then maybe redeem yourself with some spiritual wisdom?
Okay, I got a good one. Why did the pumpkin lose the boxing match? He let his gourd down.
Okay, that's
you got it. You got it. All right. Going to zero in on two words today, Matthew. Exceedingly.
I just understood
abundantly.
The joke.
Did you just get it?
He let his gourd. Okay.
Yeah, he let his gourd down.
That joke needed to simmer a little bit.
All right.
So what are we talking about?
Can you imagine how many people are laughing right now? How many men need it?
Tens and tens.
How many wives need to be encouraged by that joke?
Yeah.
All right. I'm going to go up over your song, How Good of God. And I've mentioned it before. And you close out your tours and concerts and looking forward to the
tour
ahead. Looking forward to meeting a lot of people. But how good of God, my heart can't help but see. How good of God to be so good to me. Matthew, remember when you were a child and you'd come up to me and ask me for something, a gift or just something that you would need?
Yeah.
And you know, it was my heart's desire to get you that and also just go above and beyond. When you asked for a baseball bat, I just didn't give you any bat. I gave you an aluminum bat was guaranteed to hit home runs.
That's right.
So I gave you the best. And I'm sure you feel that way about your girls when they come up and ask you for things. You not just want to give it to them, but you want to give them something special and you go above and beyond. So I want us to consider three things, how God blesses us even more with exceeding abundantly, those words. One, God's power is not limited. God is able to do exceedingly abundantly. He is all-powerful. Our key verse for today is Ephesians 3:20. Paul writes this in prison. He says, Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly beyond all that we ask or think according to the power, to his power at work in us. The word exceedingly means to a very great degree, exceptionally, tremendously. The word abundantly means large quantities, plentiful. God's power is not limited in any way. And sometimes in our minds, sometimes the devil can whisper and say, God can't do this one. But God's power is never limited. Two, he plans to go overboard in blessing each one of us. Luke 6:38, give and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together and running over, will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. And here's one commentary. It says, in biblical days, when grain was measured out to a customer, it was common for the customer to sit with their basket in their lap, and it would be measured out to them. It was customary that they would fill the basket until it overflowed. Then the vendor would shake the basket, press it down, and repeat the process until the grain literally overflowed again into the customer's lap. This is exactly how Jesus wanted us to visualize his blessing to us. Not just adequate, but overflowing. And thirdly, open your arms and receive. Ask in faith, believing. What was the end of our key verse that Paul wrote in prison? He wrote, according to his power at work in us. Now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly, according to his power that works in us. Let your faith soar. Ask, and then open wide your arms in faith, believing. Get ready for a downpour. Jeremiah 3:3, call to me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things which you do not know. My dad advice for today is to realize that God is all powerful, and whatever you need him to do for you, he already knows. And he is able and planning to go at exceedingly and abundantly above and beyond what you can even ask or think when you dare to believe. Begin to see God's blessings in your life.
That's awesome. Thanks, Dad. Hey, that's our show for today. I want to thank my buddy Jeff for joining me here at the Story House. It was so much fun to talk about all things music and Christian music, and just he's incredibly talented. And now you can have a face with the name and know that behind some of your favorite songs that you hear on the radio or wherever you listen to music, there's a good chance he's had some part in that song. It's pretty cool to see. So thank you guys for joining me week in and week out. Thanks to my dad and our ministry, Pop We, is here to serve and love on you. We'd love to hear your story of what God's doing in your life. If you've always thought, I want to tell my story, but I don't know how, we want you to know that your story matters. You can go to popwe.org today. You can share your story. You can write it down or send a video. You can also send us a prayer request. We've got a prayer network that would love to lift you up every week. Whatever you're going through, we just want you to know that you're not going through it alone. Lastly, every Thursday, I send out a weekly email devotional called Day One Devos. And have you signed up for that yet? I mean, maybe you didn't even know about it. Well, you can sign up now at popwe.org, P-O-P-W-E.org. Sign up and you'll start receiving. It's just a gift from me to you. I write it out of my own quiet times, just a little reminder for you to spend some time with Jesus, because that's how to live the most fulfilling story with your life, is by reading the greatest story ever told. So speaking of story, it's your story for his glory, and I'll see you next week.